And before we begin our final session, I would like to thank Berkley Insurance Company Reinsurance for sponsoring this afternoon's break. This afternoon, we're in for a real treat. Our session is called Old Myths and New Realities of Leadership. Our speaker grew up in a rural Midwestern town of Manchester, Iowa, where as a young teacher, he saved up money for college by working on the town's garbage route. Till this day, he says that it was the best job I've ever had in my entire career. Our speaker has been a salesman, college administrator, teacher at Oxford University, and an administrator of a 350-bed trauma center hospital. In 1983, he gained national attention when he finished in the final three of the World Championship of Public Speaking, a contest which includes over 20,000 contestants from over 45 different countries. He is a member of the International Hall of Fame for Speakers and has shared the platform with American greats like Bob Hope, Lee Iacocca, Robert Schuller, and others. And I have had the personal pleasure and privilege of working with and hearing David speak before, so it gives me great pleasure to introduce David Okerlund. Please help me welcome him.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. It is a pleasure to be here, and for a pleasure for a number of reasons. I have to tell you something very personal. I was looking forward to being in this hotel because a friend of mine, how many people here know Dennis Waitley? Dennis Waitley is probably one of the greatest psychologists in this country. He heads up the psychology programs for the Olympic athletes, has worked with them for years for the federal government. He set up the mind games for the Apollo astronauts. He's written about 15 different books, spends time. He just got back from 2 months in China and Africa. A brilliant man, a quiet river of knowledge. And I was talking to him the other day, and he was reminding me of a story he told me before, and it happened in this hotel, in this banquet hall. He said, one thing about speakers, he said, we have a tendency every now and then to get a little too full of ourselves, you know, we feel pretty good because we have, you know, a great audience, or we get a standing ovation or something like that. And he said, I was at that point in my life, and he said, I was feeling good about myself because I was asked to address Congress. And he said, for a speaker, to have the opportunity to give advice to Congress was sort of a special thing. But the night before he was to address them, they had a banquet in this hall. And he went to the banquet, and he said he walked in the front doors, probably those doors right there, and he looked around and he saw all these tables filled with all these dignitaries, and he just marveled that he was one that was going to be able to speak to him in the morning. And all of a sudden he looked over there, and there was Teddy Kennedy at a table motioning like this. And he said to himself, you know, that really made him feel good. Here I am, and Ted Kennedy notices and recognizes me. And so he said he briskly walked over there and said, how are you doing, Senator Kennedy? And he said, fine. Can you get me some more rolls? All of a sudden, he became a maitre d'. He said it was sort of a humbling experience. So it was sort of fun to be here and to be a part of that. People wonder, when you look at a speaker and hear a speaker, what the speaker is like, what his philosophies are, what his attitudes are. And I had a very interesting opportunity a number of years ago. I was out in California speaking to a urban ag banquet, about 15,000 people. And the person who was going to introduce me knew that I liked to write a lot of poetry. And she said, David, she said, would you do me a favor? She said, instead of using a standard introduction, would you write a poem that would explain to the audience your philosophy on life? And see, I'm one of those people who love change. I love change and I love challenge. I'm one of those people that believe the time to change is when you don't have to. You know, fix it all the time. If it ain't broke, break it. If it won't break, at least bend it. And my favorite philosophy in life is sacred cows sometimes make the best burgers. So I respond. I said, I'm not sure that I can, but I said, I will try. I'll never forget, I was out in California, and she stood up in front of 15,000 people, and she said, I want to introduce our speaker by a poem that he wrote about himself, the title of which is called For Both Heroes and Nerds. This is David Okerlund. It goes this way. I'm a little bit better than yesterday, and I plan to be a little bit better tomorrow. And I'll manage it all, whether I stumble or fall, despite the disappointments, heartaches, and sorrow. For you see, I'm not perfect. And quite frankly, I don't want to be. Because if perfect came due with each rendezvous, who could stand living with me? So I've learned to laugh at my failures and to be modest with every success. And when I screw up, hey people, I just empty the cup. Because who really needs all that stress? Oh, I still strive for improvement, and a challenge is something I adore. But not every seed produces a crop. And not every failure produces a flop. For success is seldom found in the score. So when you feel the heat of the blowtorch and you're pressed hard to the wall by the flame, just remember these words written for both heroes and nerds. You don't have to win every game. See, that's where I'm coming at. I'm not okay and you're not okay, but that's okay. All right? And I'm going to challenge you today to take a look at something that you probably don't look at that often. I'm going to have you look at it in a way you've never maybe seen it before, because there are some old myths and there are some new realities to leadership today. And the change and the transfer of what you need to do is happening in such a short period of time with this ongoing, unrelenting world of change and chaos that we're in. And the dynamics of leadership are about as dynamic as the last program you saw, the generational changes. In fact, in some ways, it's even greater than what you saw. And if we don't understand them, we are going to lose a great opportunity to make an impact on our people the way they need to be impacted. You know, I have maybe 85 books on leadership at home. I have, you know, the 21 irrefutable laws of leadership. I have Good to Best. I have, you know, Primal Leadership. But there's something about them that is not being said, and that's kind of what I'm here to say today. See, people say, well, you know, why are we here? Why are we even going through this? And I'm sure you've heard these before, but I'm going to just go through them briefly. We're in this world of, you know, we used to be, you know, way back had the agricultural era, and then we had the industrial era, then the informational era, and those started picking up a little rapid as we went along, but all of a sudden we went from the information era to the era of creativity. Now we're out of creativity and we're into chaos, and some people believe that, you know, the chaos is just gonna, you know, just beginning. We haven't even scratched that surface. Where you have to think like a beginner, where you have to realize that if you can't teach an old dog new tricks, maybe it's time to take the dog to the vet. You know, you wouldn't have said that 50 years ago. You would not have said that, but you can't afford not to think about it today. You know, Kao in his great book, Jamming, probably put it best. He said, we're here because a number of influences. Number one, the world of technology and its information. The technological information that has come down to this world is unbelievable. It's like a huge mass of snow on the Rocky Mountains that has gathered, a blizzard that has continued from about the beginning of 1990 and has just amassed itself. And finally, the springtime came. Finally, that snow's going to go somewhere, and the avalanche began to fall, and it started cascading down. And if you think the avalanche is going to end, you're in for a big surprise, because it's just begun. By the year 2015, the information base in America will double every 24 to 30 hours. Think about that. That's a new set of encyclopedias every day. That's what we're coming to. And so we have all this information, and that's one of the things. It wants to go somewhere, and it's going somewhere, and we're going to go with it, or we're going to get buried. I was speaking to the Indiana Medical Association, and I was talking to about 500 doctors. I said, you know, you people are in big, big doo-doo. You've been the captain of the ship, and you haven't been paying attention, and there's this huge hurricane called change and chaos, and now all of a sudden you've been washed off your pedestal, and you're down in the bowels of the ship, and if you want to be a part of the dynamics in the future, you better be able to learn how to ride the avalanche. You better learn how to ski. And I can look at every industry and see the same thing. Kao says we're here because it's also the information era has turned into the era of knowledge. And knowledge is what adds value to information. If you ever wondered why we came up with, who came up with that value added? What is value added? That's knowledge adding it to information. And because of that, you know, those people who are the entrepreneurs saying, let's take this change, let's take this chaos, and let's not just be reactive, let's not fight it, let's dance with it, let's turn it into new products, let's turn it into new services. Let's say I wonder if and dance. We're here because of the primacy of design. He who gets there first gets the big cookie. You know? And whoever creates the program, whoever creates the new policy, you know, the demand to be there. We're there because this is the era of the customer. And the customer, for the first time, is the boss. The customer doesn't expect you to just perform. Today, the customer expects you to perform. And there's a big difference between the two. Cato says we have come to a point where we have to reinvent ourselves. Yeah. There comes a point in any organization where to respond to the future, you have to rise to the next level. Miss that opportunity and you will begin to decline. We're here because, and maybe most importantly, is because today, because of what's happening, our leaders must turn from controllers of creativity to emancipators. And that's a role most CEOs have never had to face before. That's a role most CFOs have never had to face before. To think creatively, to think, how am I going to deal with this? How am I going to create an environment that will enrich ideas on a constant basis? Because you can have all the research and development departments in the world. 75% of the inventions that come forth in any organization don't come from R&D. They come from the front lines. They come from people down here who have been encouraged and liberated to stay creative and to dance with this change in chaos. So in essence, what I tell people and what I hope you can understand, and I want you so desperately understand, is that we're entering into a wormhole, I use it. A wormhole that's going to transport us, going to transport your insurance industry, going to transport banking, going to transport agriculture across a galaxy of new concepts and ideas. A galaxy that is so fast that no past or present futurist has ever come close to predicting the magnitude. And on that premise, I contend to you, you need to move from classical management, classical leadership, into expedition management. Think about that word, expedition. When I think about it, I think of Lewis and Clark. I think of Magellan. I think of Marco Polo. I think of people. It is a time period where we are going into the unknown. We are going into areas that you've never even thought of before. And that is like an expedition. The difference today is when Magellan and Lewis and Clark, a limited amount of people took those expeditions. Today, everybody's on the ship. Everybody is on the journey. No one will be left behind. And for some, it'll be an adventure of greatness, of challenge, of satisfaction. For others, it'll be like standing, looking over a giant precipice of doubt and fear. And the interesting thing is that some of the people in this room today will be the crafters of this new world. Expedition management isn't classical management. Expedition management, to fetter the axle of your leadership to the desired payload of productivity that you want out of your people, you've got to think like a leader of that expedition. Because if you don't, your organization will become stranded, stunted, and shackled within a very short period of time. It is a time period when you're thinking expedition management where your core mission statements have to be, you know, vital. They have to be carefully crafted. They have to have challenge. They have to have the kind of clarity that draws people into it so that there's ownership. If it's nothing but a facade, I remember when I was assistant administrator of that 350-bed trauma center, we created our mission statement as something to go into our annual report, something that would look good in the press releases in the community, something that would sell to our board of trustees. But they weren't necessarily a reflection of what we really deeply felt about, what we really deeply cared about. Because they were generated more for publicity and public relations than anything else. But they today will be the Ark of your covenant. The core mission for, you know, for Magellan, the core mission for Lewis and Clark was so specific, so well crafted. Everyone knew it and everyone had ownership in it. And if that doesn't happen in your organization together, those core mission statements and those, the value and worth of that will peel like the bark on a dead tree. Today, facing this world of change and chaos, keep in mind one thing, that all those who serve you, all those who work for you, all those you nurture, all of them will keep one unfettered eye, and that will be on the mast of your integrity. Let that mast crack. Let those sails shred. And you will be thrown upon the barriers and the reefs of discontent again. I love history. And I came across an interesting quote I'd like to share with you from Admiral Parry in his quest for the North Pole. He wrote this about expedition. But think about it in terms of your organization, all right? He said, an expedition is an exhilarating journey into the unknown, where uncertainty and challenge await you with every waking. Does that sound familiar to the insurance business today? It is fraught with a host of opposing elements ready to dismantle one's quest. Do you have a little opposition? Thus, there is a constant danger of defeat, but also the seduction of conquest and victory. However, its success is greatly dependent upon the unity and dedication of the entire membership. Trust is the foundation. Faith is the mortar that binds it all together. And if leaders fail to provide either, the expedition is married to the bridegroom of defeat. If nurtured, however, the expedition becomes a formidable contender for success. God grant me the power to nurture that success. Admiral Parry. A number of years ago, I had a chance to do a speech in Omaha, Nebraska. I was speaking to a young youth group. At the banquet, there was a dignitary, a local dignitary that was going to be there greeting the people. I was going to do the keynote. Now, keep in mind, I'm not a financial man. I haven't seen our checkbook in 8 months. I wouldn't know what's in the bank. My wife takes care of all that. So consequently, not being a financial person, I didn't realize who was sitting next to me. But he was a very, very fascinating individual. And we were talking about, you know, this crazy new world that we're in. We're talking about the, you know, the key ingredients that need to be there that weren't there in the same light that they were before. And I listened to him. I was enamored by him. I soaked it in like a sponge. Not knowing that the person who was talking to me about success in the future had a strange name that I didn't even pay much attention to at that particular time, because Warren Buffett sounded funny to me. But I'm going to share a little bit of Buffett with you, because we parallel the same kind of thought. The key ingredients for an expedition are the key ingredients to management today. They're nothing new, but the way they're handled is, and that's what you need to be aware of. The first thing Warren Buffett said, you know, first of all, everything starts with a dream. Without the dream, there is no quest. So the first perspective you got to look at a little differently is what I call vision questing. But there are two elements of vision questing. One is the courage to craft, and the second is the ability to resonate. One, we are normally very good at executives. Two is where we fail. Let me give you an example of both. I love old stories. I collect old stories. And the courage to craft can be told no better than a story about Sir Samuel Brown in England. A wonderful little old country gentleman in England who lived on the Tweed River. And his passion for life was his rose gardens. He had rose gardens on both sides of the Tweed River on his estates. And he would nurture them. He loved them every day and he admired them. But finally came to a point where he had a major problem, a major roadblock in his life. He developed arthritis. And to get to the other side of the Tweed River to tend the roses on the garden on that side, he had to go by horseback or horse and carriage up about 5 miles of the Tweed River to the only existing bridge, cross over the bridge, and then come back to the other side. And that took its toll. And one morning, Sir Samuel Brown, in the early morning, is sitting on this side, on a bench on this side of the Tweed River. He's having his early morning tea, and he's looking around, and there in the path, like the pathway between the aisles here, all of a sudden he saw something I'm sure you've all seen before. All of a sudden he saw a spider's web. A spider's web that was woven from this side of the path to the other side, caught in the early morning dew. I'm sure you've all seen that before. It's sort of like a Monet painting. And he sat there and he's looking at it, he's admiring it. All of a sudden, he thought, I wonder. And he got up and he kind of gingerly walked over and he got closer and closer and he got down on his knee and he looked at that and he looked at it in a way he had never looked at before. He looked at its structure. He looked at how it was put together. And all of a sudden, he thought, I wonder. I wonder if I might, with ropes and cable, make a spider's web. Not across the path, but across the river. A little spider's web that I could go right from here over to the other side and tend my roses. And that's when a little 52-year-old country gentleman gardener invented what we call today the suspension bridge. Not a genius, not an engineer, not an architect, but someone who had the courage to create, who didn't let any barrier stand before his desire to get something accomplished, who could not only get out of the box, but throw the box away. And great leaders, and I think probably in your company, you can all look and, you know, I've seen Marilyn dance. I know what she can do. And she, you know, she can dance with some farmers in Northern Iowa who look like they've been weaned on a pickle. I mean, they're all puckered up. They don't want to smile about it. I remember a couple. I'm not going to mention any names. But they're like that. But the second side of the vision is the ability to resonate the vision. And that's where I would venture to say that about 90% of the major managers, executives with insurance companies, fall flat on their face. That brings me to the second story. How many people remember S&H Green Stamps? Raise your hands. How many people here were convinced by their mother that it was a treat to lick and stick all those stamps in that book? You know, my mother said, if you're really good, I'll let you lick and stick the green stamps. For those young tigers and tigresses that are here that don't know what I'm talking about, S&H green stamps were things that you got from merchants in your community. I imagine all over the United States because they were pretty popular. And you'd buy some pots and pans or something, and you would get certain, you'd get these green stamps, and you'd put them in these books, and you'd fill the book up. The book would start off about that thin, but after you got all those stuck in there, that grew up to about like that. And after you had 3 or 4, you're smiling, you've been there, you've done that, or yeah, okay. And you got 3 or 4, they had a nice catalog, and in that catalog were things that you could trade it in for. 3 books would get you a toaster, 4 books might get you a bicycle. Well, I remember it was about 1974, and at that particular time, I was a salesman for Pitney Bowes. How many people remember Pitney Bowes? Metered mail. And all right, well, that was the time, you know, we had copiers and collators and inserters and mail openers, not just mailing machines. And all of a sudden, Pitney Bowes one time came up with an idea for a new contest. They decided to give us points for combination sales that we had of their product line. We collected the points over a 4-month period of time, and then we could trade them in for prizes, and they came out with a catalog that looked very much like an S&H green stamp catalog. Now what happens when your people get a new promotion? What do they do when as soon as they get it? They probably do what we did. You know, after work we all gathered down to the local watering hole, and after a few barleys we're kind of looking it over, talking about it, and we realized that, you know, we're getting ripped off. There was too much blood, sweat, and tears in this thing. It wasn't any good, and we all kind of said, well, we're not going to pay any attention to it. They can take this thing and shove it, as far as we're concerned. Well, I remember when I came home that day, I walked into the house, I threw the stupid catalog on the kitchen table and forgot about it. That night, we're having supper, and my wife looks at this, and she says, oh, is this a new S&H green stamp catalog? I said, no. I said, it's not a green stamp catalog. Good Lord. I said, it's not that. And she said, well, it looks like a green stamp catalog. And I said, well, you know, I guess it probably is. They probably stole the idea from them. She said, well, what is it? I said, it's a contest for Pitney Bowes. We sell stuff, get points at the end, you know, not stamps. We get points at the end of 4 months. We trade them in and get stuff that's in here. And my wife is looking through this at this particular time. And then she pauses and looks at me and says, you mean everything in here is free? I said, no, don't start thinking that way. I said, everything in there is not free. There's a lot of blood in there. She said, yes, but if you had the points, we could get this stuff? I said, yeah, that's kind of how it works. And that's when my wife turned the page, and there it was. A Panasonic Harvest Gold microwave oven. Yeah. I don't know where you were in 74, but I'll tell you this. In 74, if you had a microwave oven, you had money, all right? That wasn't a toaster. That was equivalent to a plasma screen TV, one of the thin ones 56 inches wide that you'd hang on the wall. That was something people dreamt about at my age. I mean, we didn't have one. And my wife looks at it and she says, honey, look at this. Look at this. It matches the color of the refrigerator. I said, I don't care if it matches the color of everything in this house. I said, this is probably the most expensive thing in here. I said, don't even look at it. And she said, well, it sure looks pretty. I said, forget it. That night was Monday Night Football. I'll never forget. Howard Cosell was still on, I think, and I was watching television. It was about halftime, and I heard some clinkling in the kitchen. And I didn't know what was going on there, but I had to get up and get another beer, a pop. And so I got up and I came into the kitchen, and there's my wife over by the refrigerator on the counter moving stuff. I said, what are you doing? She said, I'm just seeing if there's enough room for that microwave here in the counter. I said, hon, don't go this way. You know, this is worthless, it's useless, you're going to be disappointed. Now, this is a woman who's an RN. She's written 2 books on diabetic education, a very intelligent woman, but all of a sudden, she's on some mission from God, okay? That night, I walk into the bedroom, and on the headboard, there's a picture of the microwave oven. I get up the next morning, I go in the bathroom, honest to God, I'm not exaggerating, I go in the bathroom, and I lift the stool in, and there's a picture of a microwave oven. I come home that day from work, and there she is, and she's got this little notebook, and she said, how many points did you have to get today, honey? I said, honey, I don't do this. I said, this is not good. You know, pick out something else. I'll get you some points, but I'm not going to do that. I can't do that. She said, oh, I'm just having fun, David. I'm just having fun. Yeah. 2 nights later. Now, you gotta know, I'm a gourmet cook. I do 90% of the cooking in my family now. Back then, I didn't do squat, all right? I didn't pick up my dirty underwear. But one night we came home, and my wife made, I'll never forget, it wasn't mashed potatoes. It was meatloaf, mashed potatoes, and scalloped corn. I walk into the kitchen, and it's about time to eat, and there I see it. I should have run. There on the kitchen table is a microwave cookbook. Beneath the microwave cookbook are 2 pieces of paper. My wife looks at me and she said, honey, she said, I want you to know I work just as hard as you do. I contribute to this household just as you do. And then I come home and I do all the cooking. She said, I just happened to find this microwave cookbook. And I did a comparison study. And I want you to know this, David. But the difference between conventionally cooking this meal and doing it in the microwave, there is a 48-minute differential between the two. She said, do you realize that's 48 minutes of personal time I could have devoted to you? Dirty pool. dirty pool. Then the coup de grace came. 3 days later, I came home, and there in the foyer is one of those United Way thermometers, 8 foot high, this made out of cardboard, incrementally set up with degrees and dollars and points. And there she is on her knees with a magic marker saying, where do I put the mark today? Well, let me tell you this. If you're ever in Iowa, and maybe you're going from Des Moines to Minneapolis on Interstate 35. And maybe you come to the Clear Lake Mason City exit. Maybe you're coming to see Marilyn. Maybe you'd like to see the Surf Ballroom where Buddy Holly played his last concert. Maybe you'd just like to come over and see my Moose Hoose Lodge, where I train speakers in kind of a dairy barn made into a guest home. But if you'd like a cup of coffee, give me a call. I'm serious. On our way out from the house over to the barn, if we walk by the garage and the garage door's open, remind me to take you in there, and I'll move some dusty old Silverado truck tires, and in the corner of the garage show you a dusty, deserted, dead, deceased, Harvest Gold Panasonic microwave oven that died in about 85. But for some reason, I couldn't throw it away. Now, as simple and as trite as that story sounds, I want you to realize the difference between the two. The courage to create is over here. But today, in running an expedition, a manager of an expedition team knows that you have to have the ability to resonate the dream. You have to have the ability to touch people in ways you haven't touched them before. The old saying is, you speak to someone's mind and they'll listen. You speak to someone's heart and they'll believe and take appropriate action. And that's where it is today. This new generation, if you were listening to what was said before, you know how oriented they are to the aesthetic side of life. And I take issue with Collins' book. I love Good to Great. It's one of the best books ever written. But I think it's, even as new as it is, it's a little behind time when you look at what's happening right now. Because in Collins' book, if you've ever read it, it said a lot of great leaders were very quiet, inner-oriented people that didn't broadcast well. But that didn't make a difference. They were still great. I'm not saying you can't be that great person and still be quiet. But what I'm saying is this. If you don't have the dynamic to communicate and resonate today, the odds are against you. And I tell this to CEOs all the time, and I sort of get this look, it gets sort of defensive, and I can kind of even sense it out here a little bit. You know, when you look at the statistics that less than 4% of the CEOs and CFOs in the United States consider themselves even adequate communicators. But then for some reason, you know, it's one of the hardest sells. I can sell a speech on creativity. I can do a jamming session. I can talk about people, about the joys of stress and stuff like this. But to get somebody to say, yes, I am willing to commit to become a better communicator. I'm willing to say I will put my executive staff through an executive training program to learn the ideas and the dynamics of persuasion and motivation. It's something that they're afraid of. It's like a ghost, an ogre in the night. And the expedition manager knows he's got to communicate. He's got to speak. When you're out there like Perry was, 60 degrees below zero, you're ending up eating the sled dogs because you've run out of meat. You're 40 miles away. You're in the middle of a blizzard that you know is not going to quit for another 5 days. You're down to a little bit of water, tea, and a few biscuits, and you've half of your dog pack has been eaten. He said, that's when I needed to communicate the best. When you look at the needs of employees, then the surveys have been done.
For 50 years before, the number one thing that employees wanted from you, their leaders, was honesty. Honesty is down to number three. What people want and employees want today is they want vision and they want inspiration. That's what they need because they're in this world of turmoil where there's always, you know, there's buyouts and downsizing, right-sizing, and they see all the different things that are happening. There's uncertainty. They're in a fog of indifference. They feel like they're in the bowels of a ship traveling in the middle of the night in uncharted water, and they want somebody to communicate that the journey's going to be made safely, that you're going to get through to the other side. So I'm saying, and somebody said, well, I'm too old to become a dynamic communicator. I said, baloney. I was in the world championship. You heard Marilyn talk about in the introduction, the world championship of public speaking. I was up against over 25,000 people from 40 different countries. And you know, she was nice enough to say that David is only one of two people that finished twice in the world top three of the world championship of public speaking. That's a nice way of saying I didn't win it. But I want you to know who I lost it to. In 1984, the World Championship of Public Speaking, I lost that championship to Roy Finstermaker. You want to know something? Roy Finstermaker was 84 years old. Roy Finstermaker was just a little carpenter kind of a guy with a neck about the size of a telephone pole who simply believed that there may be snow on the roof, but that doesn't mean there's not a fire in the furnace. And got up and gave an incredible motivational speech. I thought he cheated a little bit with 14 grandchildren in the audience saying, go, Grandpa, go! But if you want to dance, then you got to learn how to sing. You know, I train executives all over this country, but you know, very few of them are willing, very few of them are excited about it. I worked with one who's, you know, Duncan Aviation, one of the executives of Duncan Aviation in Lincoln, Nebraska, and they came out and did some training. And one of the things to get them to open up, because see, we've got a problem, is that that problem is opening up. We have a problem speaking to the heart because we don't know how to use the heart. And one of the tools I used was to have them do some interpretive prose reading. And I got a letter from him. He said, Okerlund, when I went back home, I thought, you know, I keep thinking back. I'm out there in your woods walking around trying to interpret the piece of prose, The Wilderness. And I thought, you know, here I am, fangs pointed for the tearing of gashes, the red tongue for the lapping of raw meat. And I got the wolf from the wilderness, and the wilderness will not let it go. He said, I thought, you know, this is really dumb. But he said, I want you to know, it turned out to be one of the top three significant emotional events in my life. Because I kind of got into it. And I went home and started using it. And all of a sudden, my people came up and said, what was the Renaissance? It's like you've been away for treatment or something. Now he's one of the vice presidents of Raytheon Air in Wichita. And he said it was one of the most valuable things I've ever done in my life. But the problem isn't, you know, I'm not going to pick on you because it happens to all of us. The problem with most people is we have something that happens. We've got in our brain a disease. Actually, scientists will tell you, and this is true, we have three brains. We now know we've got three brains. Did you know you had three brains? Well, you do. You got a brain up here, it's called the medulla. You have a second brain that's in the heart and a third brain that's in the gut. In the gut, people, understand this. There are neural ganglia, neural cells, brain cells, absolutely identical to the ones you use up here. Not one thing is different about them. In fact, there's more brain cells in the gut than there are in the entire spinal column. Now they've also found out that we have those same neural cells, those same neural brain cells inside our heart. There's over 450,000 of those little suckers in there. And see what happens. How many of you have children? All right. You ever get the feeling you were raising the kind of kids you wouldn't want yours to play with? It has nothing to do with the speech. I just love asking that question. See the jaw drop down like, oh, who told him about my kids? Yeah. But, you know, psychologists say, who are the greatest achievers in the world? The greatest achievers when you were a child. I mean, the average salesperson of America, you know, if they had one half of the optimism and determination my daughter had when she was little, because she was a member of the greatest sales force in the history of America, you know who they are?
the Brownie Scout, Girl Scout, Cookie Brigade. If the average person had one half of the, you know, power of creativity that my daughter had back then, they'd be a millionaire today. Because 3 months later, we still had Kookaburras, Scott T's, Hoedowns, Mints, and Savannahs coming out of our cupboards, and so did every other neighbor, stranger, or friend who happened to answer their doorbell during that battle siege. You can teach a child four languages by the time before they get to kindergarten. They can dance with anything. You tell them to move a mountain, boom, they go out and move the mountain. You tell an adult to move it, and they said, you know, I kind of like it right here in the plateau. You know why they were that way? Because the three brains talk to each other. It's like that song, When You Wish Upon a Star, makes no difference who you are. The heart is the center. They know now the center of that creativity, the courage to create. The idea comes from the heart, but the second brain is here in the gut. Do you ever get that feeling? I think I can do this. I really think I can. I remember when I was on the high dive of that board, I got up there and I was hesitating and I almost backed away. And then I remember very distinctly, it was like somebody talking to me on the inside. You can do this, David. You can do this. Go and do it. And all of a sudden I whoop. Went off. But what science has found out is that within our brain we also have a thing that's called the RAS. It's the reticular activating system. That's the technical word. What it is simply this. It's the portion of your brain that tells you, better be careful. A bird in the hand is worth two in the bush any day. Marilyn, better be safe than sorry. Don't go into that new relationship. You ought not do that. Don't put all your hopes on the Hawkeyes because they may end up playing another team like Arizona State and get their you-know-what kicked. You know, it's that part of your brain that scientists now say as you go through life, it tries to cut off conversation between the heart and the gut. It says, stop acting like a child. That's stupid. That's foolish. Don't do it. Don't go there. You know, follow this track. Be careful. Be conservative. So what leaders have to do to learn how to resonate is that they got to reattach. You got to be able to talk and listen. You got to let the gut say, I think this is a good idea for our mutual. I think we can do this. I think we're going to see it. I think we'll see it through. And we proceed from there. You have to a little bit, you know, what I call rediscover the child. I wrote a poem one night. I didn't know why I wrote it. I didn't even understand it at the time. It came out of me in less than 2 minutes. I sat down and wrote this poem. It goes this way. When I was but a child, the world was a wonderful place, so full of heaven's treasures of goodness, love, and grace. I could dream like Walter Mitty. I was a cowboy. I was crowned a king. I became a crazy, lazy hobo, and I could do most anything. But then, growing older, there came a saddening day when, hearing a different drummer, I was taught another way. That men don't dream of foolish things, of puppy dogs and cows that sing. And I forgot the joy so dear, the treasured moments, the lack of fear, and sadly accepting society's ban, I deserted the child. To become the man. It's one thing to be charged with coming up with ideas. It's one thing to be challenged to stay in that primal leadership area. It's quite another to go beyond the courage to create and to be willing to adapt and adopt the principles that go along with resonating that message. But understand this, and understand it well. As Perry knew when he would talk to the men in the middle of a blizzard in the middle of the night, understand this, your people are hungering for that kind of creativity.
Your people are hungering for that kind of clarity, because that's what brings ownership. Guess who made this statement? What made me successful in life wasn't my ability to sell. What made me most successful in life was my ability to paint great vistas of what might be, and then to draw the people around me into those dreams and into those vistas of greatness. That was Bill Gates. Let me read you a couple of others. The real true source of power in any company today is ideas. The rest is housekeeping. Ideas are the DNA of everything that is worthwhile today. Marsh Fisher, co-founder of Century 21 Real Estate. Cherish your visions and your dreams as they are your children of your soul, the blueprints of your ultimate achievements. Master how to radiate them to others. Napoleon Hill. Outstanding leaders are futurists and oriented that way. They love to dream about what could be and involve others in their dreams. That's the art of effective communication. Neil Orvis, the futurist. That's number one. Create the dream and create the ability to resonate the dream. The second thing I heard that night, sitting next to what at that time I thought was just an old man, very wealthy old man. He didn't look like he was wealthy. But he said, you know, after the dream is the fire you spark. But what feeds the fire is the passion within. I've always said I love people who get up in the morning and say, good morning, Lord. But there are far too many who get up and say, good Lord, morning. You know. That's the way that's kind of what I'm talking about. Bobby Dodd probably gave me the greatest definition that I've ever heard about passion. Bobby Dodd, I think he was a coach at, I don't know if it was South Carolina, maybe somebody here knows, but this happened about 25 years ago. He said he was playing another team that they hadn't beat for 5 years. There's 42 seconds left in the game, and his team is ahead 6-0. The other team did not get a 1st and 10, so Bobby Dodd's team gets the ball. There's time for maybe 2 plays at most. The game's over with. So Bobby Dodd calls a timeout. He brings the quarterback over to the sideline. He said, now just keep the ball on the ground. Just give it to the fullback. He hadn't fumbled all year. Let him be tackled twice, and we're going to beat him. First time in 5 years, we're going to stick it to him. So the quarterback went out there in the huddle and he called the play. He got over the center just like he was supposed to. He took the ball from the snap just like he was supposed to, and he turned to give it to the fullback just like he was supposed to. The fullback got the ball but did not hit a wall of tacklers. Surprisingly, he hit an alley. He hit an opening. He broke across the 50-yard line, the 45, 40, 35, 30, 25, 20, 15, 10, 5, down to the 3-yard line where he's finally tackled. Now Bobby Dodd knows he's got victory. There's a timeout to move the chains down, but there's only one more play. They're ahead 6-0, and it's over. He's got it. Well, as he's excited on the sidelines, what he didn't realize that as the quarterback and the rest of the team were walking down there to get to where the next play was, some of the seniors came up to the quarterback and said, look, this team has not only beat us 5 years in a row, for the last 2 years they kept their first string into the fourth quarter just so they could get a higher rating, just so they could stick it to us. Let's not have the fullback get tackled here in the 3-yard line. Let's surprise them. Let's do something they don't expect. Let's make it 13-0. Bobby Dodd said if he had known that, he'd have called a timeout. But he didn't. The quarterback broke from the center just like he was supposed to. Came over the center of the ball, got behind that center, and he took the snap just like he was supposed to. He turned to give the ball to the fullback just like he was supposed to. But instead, he gave him an empty hand. And then he began to bootleg around to the right. As he bootlegged around the right, the end cut in the end zone wide open. The quarterback got up on the balls of his feet and threw the perfect pass. However, there's a defensive linebacker in the background picking his nose. Sees a pigskin. Wonders, what the hell is that doing up there? Thinks he's Michael Jordan. He leaps up in the air. He tips the ball, and it comes down into his arms. He's 4 yards deep in the end zone, and he's got the ball, and there's nobody there to tackle him. He races out of the end zone and heads down. He's going to go 104 yards down and score. The time will run out, but they'll get the extra point, and they'll steal victory 7-6. As he's racing down the sidelines, everybody knew it was over. But then all of a sudden, they saw something they hadn't seen before. All of a sudden, they saw the quarterback who had gotten knocked on his rear end get up and start racing across the field. Not on an intercept path. And he wasn't a very fast quarterback. But they were surprised at how fast he was moving. And how faster he got. And at the last moment, the quarterback did one of those Tarzan things where he leaped through the air with the back of the palms of his hands. He hit the linebacker on the 8-yard line going the other way. Knocked the linebacker out of bounds. Time's out. Victory's preserved. 6-0. Bobby Dye goes out to the middle of the field to embrace and to meet the opposing coach. He said the opposing coach got right in his face like a bulldog. He said it looked like he had rabies. He got right in his face. He said, "You got to tell me something because I don't understand this." He said, "My defensive linebacker is the fastest player I got on my team. He anchors the sprint relay teams for track." He said, "Your quarterback is flat-footed and couldn't catch himself in a paper bag." He said, "You're going to have to tell me how in the hell did your flat-footed quarterback catch my fleet-footed linebacker?" Bobby Dodd said, "That's easy, coach. Your linebacker was running for a touchdown. My quarterback was running for his very life." That's what passion is. Passion is when what is in your heart makes love to what is in your mind. And then does it again and again and again and again. And I ask you, are you running for a touchdown this year? Or are you running as you're running, as if you were running for your life? Do your people see a CFO or a CEO properly dressed, dignified, come into the office every day? Or do they see a warrior willing to dance? Do they sense not only the promise in what you say, but do they sense the passion as well? Because if they sense the passion, and they've taken ownership in the dream, then you've locked two forces together that are very, very, very difficult to defeat. I was doing communication training one time with a very interesting man, absolutely fascinating. His name is Ron Mumm. He's the past commander of the Thunderbirds organization, the key man developing his speaking potential. His brochure is going to be the picture of the planes flying 500 miles an hour, 500 feet off the ground, 5 inches away. At 500 miles upside down, 5 inches away from another plane, average doesn't make it. That's the title of his speech. But he was talking about the passion that the Thunderbirds have, and he said, it's a wonderful story. He said that their base is in Las Vegas, and Las Vegas is sort of a city there of the base. There's also a federal prison there as well. And the Thunderbirds had this, you know, and everybody that worked for the Thunderbirds had a passion about what they're doing. They nurtured it. They nurtured it deliberately with planned strategies with their mechanics and with secretaries and everything else. Everybody. In fact, they also inadvertently nurtured it with some of the inmates of the prison. Because they started a program where prisoners could volunteer to work, do groundskeeping work, carpentry work, and stuff like that, because they're within the same base, for the Thunderbirds. And they started getting excited. All of a sudden they got, you wouldn't think an inmate would be very productive, would you? You wouldn't think they'd be looking for extra work to do, would you? That's what kind of, like the warden said, in 25 years he had never seen inmates with a spit shine on their shoes. But all the inmates that, you know, felt the passion of the Thunderbirds, they did. They got out of there, walked out of their cells in the morning when they had the spit shine on their shoes because they were a member of the Thunderbirds. They were flying high. Then Ron said it got a little out of hand one time.
He said he was taking his troop over to Europe for 30 days on a tour over there. And before he left, one of the prisoners came up and said, you know, hey, boss, they called him boss. Boss, he said, while you're gone, you know that kitchen, the officer's kitchen down there in the rec area? We'd like to remodel the kitchen for you. Ron Mum said, you know, that's a wonderful idea. You know, I really appreciate it. He said, but, you know, I have a very limited budget, and I don't know that I could afford to do it. The prisoner said, oh, no, won't cost you anything. He said, we've got it all worked out. We can take care of it. We'd just like permission to go ahead and do a little remodeling for you. We want to do something special. We want to feel a little bit more of a part of that area as well. And Ron said, okay. He said, you know, that sounds kind of fun to me. Then he took off. Ron Mum said the first thing that happens whenever they're on a tour, the general demands that the first thing they do is go through the police blotter, because they have a regular police force on that base, and just to see if there's anything that they need to address that's happened while they're gone. Ron Mum comes back about 50 days later, and he's going through the blotter that evening, and all of a sudden he turns the page, and there it is, a report of stolen merchandise. The VIP headquarters for visiting dignitaries, where the Saudis and people would come in to look at new arms and new planes that they might buy, some very posh apartments. All of a sudden there's a police report of an entire set of cabinets that was missing. Corian tile had disappeared off the base, and they had didn't have any idea where it was. And all of a sudden Ron Mum thinks, oh my God, he remembered the conversation. He called up the general and went over to see him. He said, General, he said, I just got back and I'm looking through the police spot and I want to talk to you about the apartments that were ripped off. And the general said, yeah, he said, we haven't figured it out. I mean, they just evaporated. They're gone. We can't find them anywhere. We don't know who got on the base. We don't know how they got them out of there. And Ron said, well, he said, I think I can help you out there. He said, I don't want anything to happen to the people who did this. I will pay for it myself, whether it takes me the rest of my life, because they were pretty nice cabinets. And the general said, well, what's going on? He said, well, maybe you better come with me. And they drove over to the officers' area. They went down in the basement, went over there in the kitchen area, and there it was, the beautiful Corian, the cabinets. Ron Mum said, it was a dream kitchen any Thunderbird pilot would love to have had. And the general just looked. Didn't say a thing. Ron knew he was in big trouble. General turned to go. He walked out of the basement. He walked outside. He got in a chauffeur-driven car. And as Ron stood there and ready to salute him, waiting for the hammer to come down upon him, the general simply looked at him and said, they don't do bathrooms, do they? See, that's the power of passion. You saw it again. I'm thinking back to that last session. Yeah. That's what young people are looking for. Yeah. They're mobile. I mean, they'll give you your loyalty. Don't get me wrong. They can be just as loyal as my grandfather was when he went to work. And the first day he came to work, he brought his loyalty and wore it proudly and expected to be there 30 years from them to retire from that railroad. That's where he came, and that's where he just assumed he'd be, and he brought it with him. That was, you know, that was undivided. That was in-depth loyalty. I contend that young people that were going to work for you will give you that same loyalty, but you have to nurture it in a different way. You have to nurture passion where you didn't have to nurture before. You know, 50 years ago, my dad, 40 years ago, said, jump. I said, how high? I'm part of that traditional generation. Yeah. You tell a young person to jump today, they say, why? Yeah. It's not that they're not saying, I won't. Those are the ones they want to know why. So that's when you have to be passionate about it. You've got to paint that picture, and you've got to keep that fire going by feeding it through your passion as well. The third ingredient that comes into play is what he referred to as nurturing tenacious trust. Nurturing tenacious trust. I was doing some work for an ag company not many years ago. I was brought in to do a two-day team-building program from the top to the bottom. It was an animal processing company that was in such disarray, it was unbelievable, such bitterness and acrimony that was there, mainly because they had been bought and sold four different times in 5 years. And the manager wanted to bring a little bit of trust and rapport back together. So they hired me to come in. It was not an easy task. It was a daunting task. The bitterness was deep. The anger was there. There was insecurity. They didn't trust anybody, okay? And they wondered who I was, a hired gun coming in there to appease them or whatever. And it didn't run just from shipping secretaries as well, accounts receivable, payable. It was all across the board. I have never worked so hard in my life to bring a group together. It took the better than half of the first day just to get my establish my own credibility with them. Then we started off with some little extra exercises, some little things that would expose each other, you know, management to first liners, where they, you know, where they could vent a little bit and they without controlling that venting and then turn it around and make it into positive. And at the end of the day, things were starting to happen. Magic was starting to happen. And you could see there was a hunger. These people wanted to believe. They wanted to trust. They knew it because that's what they wanted most in their life. In that working environment was that ability to trust. And the next day we took off and we started doing some more things, some more exercises, getting them out of the box. All of a sudden we partnered up. People who had, I took deliberately the ringleader on the negative side of the ploys and the most important person over here, and I got them to get together and collaborate. They fused, and all of a sudden, you know, they could get past the ugliness of the past. They realized that they couldn't manage the future by looking in the rearview mirror. And we started to really dance. By the end of the second day, it was really great. It was like being at a Baptist revival. There were amens and hallelujahs. And I went home to Clear Lake, Iowa, thinking, Billy Graham, move over. David Okerlund just converted an entire company. Honest to God. The next day, at 7:45 in the morning, an email came from the home office to that organization telling them that their top 7 managers were going to be relocated to DeKalb, Illinois in the next 30 days. That a completely different team of management would be in, and they would be consolidating those 2 divisions once again. I didn't know what it was like to get death threats. But I got them. They thought I was hired to set them up for the garbage truck of life. You look at Enron. You look at WorldCom. You look at HealthSouth. You look at Martha Stewart. It's all over. And when I work with people on the front lines, they're all scared. You can't run an expedition with fear. You can't expect people to go into the management, be in the margins of greatness. You can't expect them to endure when they don't trust that you will even be there, when they feel that there is an absolute, you know, tyranny of exclusion going on in companies. I told some executives the other day, and I said it to 3M, and I'll say it to other people as well, you can't exclude anybody today. Exclusion's one of the worst things that you can do. I don't care if it's perks or beanies or whatever. You better take a good look. If you want to be able to dynamically keep that expedition together, you better make sure that everybody on that expedition is treated right. On an expedition, they all sleep in the same tents. They all eat the same food. They all bear the same burdens, and they walk and take those burdens, that journey together. I'm not saying you can't give them salary billions and stuff like that, but when you do the others, it's sort of like my wife travels with me a lot. And I always fly economy, but because I fly so much, on some airlines I get bumped up, and I really kind of like that. But if my wife doesn't, she's not, you know, silver elite or whatever, gold. And so when we're traveling together, when I get bumped up and she doesn't, I get her to sit in first class. And I remember the first time I did it. I didn't think about it when I'd been in first class 100 times. But it was on a Northwest flight. It was out of Houston, Texas, and I was going to Atlanta or somewhere else. And I said, Twyla, you're going to sit up in front. I was going to be the good husband. I was going to be, you know, and I said, you're going to be up there. And she went up there. And I was proud of myself. But then all of a sudden, What do the stewardess do? What do? It just drives me crazy. I don't know why they do that. They walk over there and they close the what? Close the curtain. We're up here. You common folk are out there. I said, that doesn't bother me much. And I'm sitting there and thinking, you know, pretty soon they're going to be bringing those pretzels and Diet Coke. And my wife, she's going to get some of that Australian wine. You know, when they serve her, she's even going to get a steam towel. I'm just going to sit here and steam. There's about 10 people up there using that one little bathroom here. There's 200 of us using that one back there. That's not right. They get to leave first. They get to drink as much wine as they want, not just wine. They get to. She'd probably be drunk by the time I get there. And I sat there, as objective as I was. I forgot how nice I was being to my wife because I was consumed by my anger at being excluded. If you're going to lead an expedition, make sure you don't do that. I'll tell you, I've seen a lot of executive parking stalls, and I've seen a lot of executives that probably look like they need to be walking a little bit more. And I'm not saying that you don't deserve it, they don't deserve it, I'm just saying you can't afford it. When you're on the North Pole, you can't afford it when you're in the wilderness. Lewis and Clark couldn't do it. You can't afford it when you're on an Apollo mission. When the money is on the line, when the future is at stake, you can't do it because you need trust. Trust. As he said in that first piece, trust is the mortar that binds it all together. And it's an old myth that needs to see a new reality. Finally, because I got 4 minutes left, I'm going to leave you one last thing. I could give you 10 more, but I'm going to leave you one more thing that he talked about, and that is the perseverance to perform selflessly. People who run great expeditions are always looking to do great little things for other people. And we pass them up. And sometimes when we pass up that opportunity to say, well done, thou good and faithful servant, or whatever, we lose a moment of glory. I will never forget when I was up in Dickinson, North Dakota one time doing a youth leadership program. I was doing a speech called You Don't Have to Be Rambo to Make It. I was telling the kids that, you know, don't keep score, keep results. I've never learned anything from a trophy. I said, you know, I love competition, but competition in America has just gone off the scale. When there's over 10,000 parents that were brought into hospital emergency wards to receive treatment from wounds they received while fighting with other parents at Little League contests every year in America, something's going crazy. When suicide by golfers is the number one death in sports that there is in America, something's gone crazy. But I'm telling kids, you don't have to be Rambo to make it. You don't have to be Tarzan all the time. And these kids had never heard this because these are the ones that are pushed to get on that turnpike of success, pushed to become the gladiators of tomorrow, pushed to take the SATs and practice 5 times before they take it in reality. My Lord, they almost had to drag me to take it once when I was in high school. And after I told them this, I had a young man come up to me and he said, I'd like to visit with you. He was a young man who was from Minot, North Dakota. He wanted to go into music ministry at Concordia College. His folks, however, he had a presidential scholarship anywhere in the United States. They wanted him to become an engineer because that's where the big bucks were. And they were great parents. He had no complaints about the parents, but they're really having this agonizing pull. And he wanted to know if I could sit down and talk to him about and give him some ideas. I didn't want to do it. I didn't. I wanted to get back. I had to drive in a pickup truck back to Bismarck to catch a plane. And it was a long drive, but I really wanted to get back to Bismarck because I wanted to go to an Indian artifact store that I knew was in the mall. And then all of a sudden the thing inside of me said, David, don't talk the talk if you don't walk the walk. Here's an opportunity to show how selfless you can be. Here's an opportunity to just listen. And we sat down in the grassy mall
at the college there. I gave him some ideas of what he might say to his parents to make them understand how important that core mission of music ministry was to him. I gave him some ideas and some things to read. I gave him my phone number to call. And I left. Quite frankly, I didn't think I had accomplished anything. And then I got home, and the next week I went to the mailbox. In the mailbox, there was a little box from Minot, North Dakota. I opened it up. On top of a wad of cotton is a little note that says, "Dear Mr. Okerlund, thank you for taking the time to listen to me, because in so doing, you took this out of the gun." And I didn't know I had done anything worthwhile at all. Great leaders don't look for great moments. Great leaders understand that it's the little things that make people great. It's the little things. That sense of selflessness that has to balance that sense of selfishness. I'm not saying you can't be selfish, but I'm saying great leaders know that when they're on that journey in the dark, in the unknown, that there's a time when a little word, a little gesture, a little thought might make all the difference. Yeah. It's a crazy world. Yeah, there's lots of things to be afraid of. But if you learn to manage your organization like an expedition, I will guarantee you, your people will say, "Lead the way, and we'll follow." Thank you, and God bless.
Thank you, David, for that wonderful presentation. And on behalf of the Farm Conference, we thank you also. And please remember, as you leave the room, to leave your evaluation sheets, that it helps us plan for next year. And with that, we conclude the Farm Conference program. Have a great rest of the convention. Thank you.